Hi, I'm Dr. Gina Mackenzie, host of the Philadelphia Cultural Forum on the educational channel of the Community College of Philadelphia.
Tonight we have with us Larry Mackenzie, professor of English at the Community College of Philadelphia. Larry holds an MFA from the University of Oregon. His play about the U.S. Customs Bureau versus the sculpture of Constantine Brancusi, Wazo Watsat, was staged in 2004 at the Community College of Philadelphia. Here he is also the developer of our Leadership Studies program. His work in the classroom at the college has been recognized by the Alana Kalos Award and with the Lindback Award for Distinguished Teaching. His essay about working class students, A Pedagogy of Respect, appears in the collection Coming to Class, which was published in 1998 by Boynton Cook and Hyndman. This summer, he is determined to work on his latest children's book. Welcome, Larry.
Thank you.
Our pleasure to have you tonight. So your work as a writer is really broad in scope, ranging from poetry to playwriting to children's books. What attracts you to poetry as a genre?
Well, everybody likes to write poems because they can be written without it turning into a huge project. Writing a novel is going to take you months, years. Poems often, wonderful as they might be, and you might rewrite them many times, but still you can write a poem in a day or a week. A good poem, too.
As yours are. What inspires you as a poet?
I think I'm a storyteller, and I like to tell stories in the poems. So inspiration, just the ironies of everyday life, things that just come to me, things I see, that somehow they seem like they should be captured somehow. Also, poetry gives you permission to write in rhythmic or musical language more than other kinds of writing.
Very true. Where do you find inspiration in the history of literature? Like, what poets do you look for?
Who I was a big Chaucer. I'm a big Chaucer fan. I studied Middle English and Old Icelandic, and I really liked the sagas, Icelandic sagas, but mostly I like Middle English, and I like Gawain and the Green Knight. I like the Canterbury Tales. And
so that's where the narrative
Yeah, the characters. I like the characters that Chaucer created, and I like the idea of recognizing strange characters and interesting characters in modern films and modern movies. And I like inventing such people myself.
And I think in the work that we're going to hear from you, we're going to hear that narrative bent and those interesting characters that,
well, let's hope so,
saying, are endowed by your studies. So the first poem that we'll hear about tonight is from the Yakima Valley Tennis Court Tale. Is this inspired by anything in particular?
I have no idea where this came from.
How fascinating.
Well, maybe I did, but I don't remember the beginnings of it. It's just a story. Yakima Valley is where I grew up in Washington State. I was a farm kid, and this poem is fictionalized, I suppose, but I think it probably comes out of my childhood and my teenage years. I used to pick asparagus before and after school. Used to pick apples. Hang out with the migratory, the migrant workers who were also harvesting crops in Yakima Valley.
Cool. Can we hear it?
Sure.
Great.
Yakima Valley Tennis Court Tale. Our social studies teacher, Murdo Scott, an ex-gob machinist and first mate whose sea legs hexed the sad apple grove he'd bought, was also our hairy monster tennis coach, who taught us not much more than how to keep score by love, deuce, and such, but could hold three Wilson balls in his right hand, serving left. Big and fast, hard on the hearts of female teachers, good to heft furniture, tattoo cow's ears, and make bull calves into steers, he yelled a lot in class, but not on the court. There, he smiled and served like a priest, then rushed the net and had us all whelmed. My older sister, Elma, home from off somewhere east, had been thought dead till her postcard came. showed up one day in tennis gear, went up to Scott and said, "See this apple? It came from your orchard. You should pay more attention to that orchard. I will squeeze you cider or send you back to sea if I don't serve you deadly and volley long and free." He laughed. "Squeeze me cider? Girl, you're on." But when they played her sharp and skillful game, Elma outlasted him, outsweated him, outshone, made him wild, took him in straight sets. At the end, Scott glistened like a god. He's quieter now with his chalk in the classroom, and he serves the orchard well, spends long, beamish hours in his apple coaxing job. The cider is sweet. Elma coaches tennis, carrying their second child.
One thing that we hear immediately as we listen to you is the different rhythms and the way in which Elma's speaking voice is in a different form than the rest of the poem. Can you talk about how you use form to convey characterization? How you choose that, even?
I don't know. I think I'm just listening to this character, and she talks in the way she talks. She's brash. She's the comeuppance for him. She's practically speaking in rhyme. I mean, how people in real life don't normally speak in rhyme, but I can imagine her speaking in rhyme because she's basically had her eye on him, and she's going to take him down a peg or two. But as he gets taken down, he gets to be sort of turned into somebody who glistens like a god because he's covered with sweat because he lost. I like ironies like that. And I like the language that she speaks. She gets to do the speaking in the poem other than the narrator. So it's really her poem.
Definitely. And her voice shines through so clearly. Talk about, you mentioned that she spoke to you. Is that how characters normally come to you? Do you hear them in your head?
I hear the beginning sometimes in my mind. Or there's kind of an obsession with a word or a phrase or a picture in some kinds. Something comes out of that. I mean, it's fiction. I don't have an older sister, Elma. I'm the oldest kid in my family. I have a younger sister. But a lot of the stories that I've been working on for children involve kids, but especially girls, who are spunky or who are strong or who are heroic in some way.
Do you find it a challenge as a writer to assume the female voice?
I think the readers have to make up their minds about that. It doesn't seem that hard, no.
Excellent. The poem.
But if my 10-year-old daughter sees this show, she will definitely say, "He doesn't know what girls are like. He doesn't know how they talk."
Do you use your daughter as an audience? At least for your children's work, not for the more sophisticated
work. A little bit. Mostly I look at things that she creates more than she looks at things that I create.
The poem really juxtaposes two different worlds. We have the agrarian world set against the schoolroom. And juxtaposition is of worlds. The irony that you talk about is a theme throughout all of your poetry. In the next poem that you're going to read to us, Break Bank, we can kind of visualize the working class, blue-collar world against this rarefied world of Monte Carlo. And that's where the poem sort of begins. Can we hear that now and then talk
sure.
a little bit about
sure.
it?
Sure. To break the bank at Monte Carlo was my ambition before I turned 7. I knew the women in gowns and men in suits at Monte Carlo stared long at big, spinning, red and black wheels. And my dad, home from the salt mines, the machinist, groaning over his check stubs, said he was spinning his wheels, and once at our bank, I stared hard as a bald man in a blue suit gravely spun the shiny steering wheel of the high, massive brass vault. Robbers, bank robbers, went to prison, but I knew from movies you could escape, muscle and leap over the prison wall with a pole vault. scheming even as you landed, how once again to break the bank at Monte Carlo. In my dream, those who did it like Samson, pulling down pillars, their gambling muscles abloom with Popeye bulge. Gritting and nearly gagging, I fed the wish with cans full of spinach. Samson had waited, hair slowly lengthening, waited, waited, then risking it all, heaved. Nothing left but Philistine dust. I'd heard of things going bust, Hanford or bust, on our pickup truck, starting out north from Denver, hunting a better wage, flats and blowouts of 1943. My dad, the machinist, hauling us to Sagebrush, Washington to help build the bomb, the one whose inferno and plume would let fall a million Nagasaki tears. Even then, he tired and the others tired in line, waiting for Friday's sacred paycheck. Sometimes they brushed from their ears echoes of the great crash of 29 and hummed a wishful wartime tune. Wiser at 11, I no longer pictured breaking the bank like Samson, God's long-haired pancake, but safely from outside, like pulling a cartoon tooth with a string tied to a cartoon doorknob. Growing up, I learned about dynamite, the FDIC, the IMF, saw how sheer waiting for CEO salaries to climb, the stock options to mount up in heaps, yes, piling up the pure weight of naked wealth could do it. The mass of coin and financial electrons, $1 billion transfer, one damned virtual silver dollar too many, the floor of the bank sagging, and the money, the bonds, tons of copper, silver, nickel, bloody diamonds, gold, and hand-greased paper. Roosevelt, Truman, Eisenhower, McNamara, suits in Switzerland, Singapore, Paris, Tokyo sucked into, Reagan, Bush, and Greenspan, mortgage-backed insecurities all reaching out too late, the floor collapsing, the poor despairing, then cheering for woman and mankind, all bankers' trillions tumbling massively, spilling down, oh, so deep, right into the dead laps of the thousands of ancient miners sitting down there, aching, nothing but bones, layers and layers beneath, waiting for this moment of justice, ruin, and the chance for a clean break.
Unlike the first poem that you read to us, which was so intimate, this poem has a historical scope, an age trajectory for this character. Can you talk about that trajectory?
Well, I'm 70 years old. I grew up during, as a little kid during World War II. My dad worked, he didn't know that he was working on a bomb for Nagasaki. We were at Hanford, Washington. It was part of the Manhattan Project, which we didn't know at the time. You found out all of it later. My parents and others felt pretty good at the end of World War II. They thought they'd helped end the war. They didn't. Much later, my dad told me that he's in his 60s, he started to think about the bomb and changed his mind about whether the bombs should have been dropped in Japan. One of the bombs he had helped make as a machinist. But the part about the money, I think as a working class kid, I was interested in why are some people rich? Why are some people poor? Why do some people work hard and still not do well?
So unlike the first poem that you read for us, is this poem is much more autobiographical?
Yeah, I think so. I think it is. Hanford or bust, flats and blowouts of 1943. We moved from Colorado to Washington in a truck, pickup truck. And yeah, there's a lot of memories in this poem, and some fantasy.
Is it difficult to poeticize your own life?
I don't think I like the word poeticize.
Okay.
This poem has changed over time, and it reflects some of my own fantasies as a little kid. But it just grew into a poem. It's a story in language that looks like a poem, and sounds like a poem. I like the way it builds, and I like the disaster that I imagine in the poem.
Well, and it builds to that great last phrase, a clean break. What would a clean break mean for you as a writer? Is it possible to start over?
Yeah, and while I'm getting older and it's harder to imagine starting over, but starting over is something that, the grapes of wrath. I grew up with the idea that you could have a rough time, but you could migrate, you could go somewhere else, you could start over and take a new shot at the American dream. And I believe that the poem that I just read is probably a version of that. It was written largely before we have the current economic crisis, but it certainly resonates today.
Yeah, fits right into our situation. Breaking through and breaking into things seems to be another major theme in your poetry. And the next poem that you're going to read to us, Calling Through Glass, is about breaking through or the inability to break through. Can you share that poem with us?
Sure. Yeah, this poem's about communication, I guess. Or it's kind of a love poem. Calling Through Glass. You're netted in a house. We shout through glass. I call, come out! You say, there's no door. I watch your house's lives where they have settled. From what and by what right do I want to save you as you draw your oat spelt, airy loaves from confection cave, chop carrots, celery, tear arugula for salad beneath those hanging matched titanium kettles. You bake leeks in fine white wine, pluck two hens, shave mangoes, flavor with chives. NPR now, Queeg-like, fingers the latest polls. You stir, hum a child ballad, and watch on cable, Patricia Spends. Betcha, skate leap topless over 500 end-to-end biodynamic egg rolls. For the fifth time I call, come out. You say, no door. Still with the chopping, the expertise, the gourmet shards. You watch Narcissus pray to himself, chant like an anchor to sell health. He tosses a GE premium dishwasher balloon straight up. Moist with his own petard, he grins detergent for the cameras. Arnold goes green and laughs while Echo cries high above Los Angeles. I put my mouth to your window. Please, turn off those lives. In your best bedroom, you slowly stick an orange with cloves to give a dim odor to silks in a drawer. Do you beckon me to join you instead? I can't come in there. Nature boy, I'm a bone stuck in a tree. Come out and get me. The moment you crash through it, any window becomes a door. As the shards fly, I'll blow them away from your hurling torso, your tender shoulders, your precious head.
There's two very distinct moods in this poem. The caution of the first two-thirds of the poem, juxtaposed again against the passion of the last two stanzas as they're written. Can you talk about how you achieve that break for the reader or for the listener? It's very jarring and very effective at the same time.
I guess I've liked the poetry of Cummings and other poets who were lyrical and yet had a satiric genius. Mm-hmm. This poem has sardonic and satiric themes and tones in it. In the background, I guess Arnold Schwarzenegger, I suppose. The poem takes a swipe at mass culture, at television, even at NPR, which I myself listen to quite a lot. Maybe it's like the old film, The Graduate. There's a world in which there are suburban, simple but closed channels. There are people who are isolated. There are people who are lonely. The talking through glass has always been poignant for me, the idea of being separated by windows or by glass. And maybe the poem captures that. And maybe the passion at the end is partly frustration.
Is poetry itself an unmediated form? Does it allow us not to talk through glass?
I think really good poems do. I think they're very good poems are honest. They're artful, but there's if the poem doesn't arrive at an honest place, then it really shouldn't be considered finished or even a successful effort.
Poetry so often gets characterized as being a rarefied art or an art for the elite, an art that sort of we attach ourselves to when we're very young. Children write poetry a lot, and then we forget that art as we get older. Even as writers, mm-hmm. a lot of us abandon poetry and move towards fiction, but you stay with it. Mm-hmm. What are you trying to do by staying with poetry? Do you think it can be made a more accessible art?
Yeah, I'm really interested in storytelling, as I said before, and the novels that I've been working on for young people, they all have stories within the story, and they all have poems inside the prose. And maybe that's so I can have my cake, you know, and of course eat it too. But the I like the poetry gives the characters a chance to sing or to perform. I mean, this last poem that I brought with me today is from a children's novel. It's called Potter's Quest, or maybe Zhuzhana's Quest. And it takes place in the 17th century. It's about a girl who wants to be a sculptor. And she lives in a kingdom where the powers that be arrest all artists. Not so much to suppress them exactly, but to own them. This is the king is basically selfish and wants creators and craftspeople to all belong to him and to be under his control.
Fascinating.
And this poem is called Song of the Wounded Painter. And I imagined somebody who had run afoul of the powers that want to crush creativity and maybe had given up. Or appeared to be given up. So this is his story and his voice. I once was an artist who painted no lie. Now I sweep and sigh. Tira-tara-tai, tara-tai. With my palette and paints, a big and little brush, I could paint the truth of a stallion's flashing eye, a monarch's frowning jaw, a maiden's blush. My paintings couldn't lie. I made images of fair ladies and lords posing at the ball or handling swords. They sat for portraits, hours on end, to the envy of their friends. I could paint heroes in my sleep, royal toddlers, gown-bedecked ladies, a mare's flying mane, a hillside's daisies, art to make the maidens weep. Tira-tara-tai, tara-tai. Then came an order to paint old Baron Quartz and his brother, the Duke of Blur, destroyers of five heretic forts, leaders of wealthy, cruel, and sure. Tira tara tai, tara tai. I painted them enthroned, Blur and Quartz, their proud noses, gleaming eyes, the Duke's small chin, the Baron's warts. Truth was my mistake, friends. I didn't paint awake, friends. I should have run, should have vanished. For when my work was finished, the Baron looked and barked a curse. The Duke called me rebel, cretin, and worse. Me, a painter who couldn't lie. Tira tara tai, tira tara tai. I'd expected gold, a mighty sum. Instead, they called me kook. I was pummeled dumb by the soldiers of the Duke, whipped to prison a la drum, tada dum, a dum, tada dum. Did it hurt? Did blood soak through my shirt? What I tell you is no lie. I thought I would die. I sweep the streets now, friends. Do no portraits of any kind. You have a painter's eye? Better you were blind. If you think yourself an artist, I can tell you're not the smartest. Tira tara tai, tara tai. Be a jailer or a duke. Be a soldier, not a kook. Not a sculptor or a dancer. Art is not the answer in these scary, scary times, these oh-so-dangerous times. In the duchy of Blur, we are shallow now, not deep. Sweep, only sweep. Imagine and weep.
So many references. We hear Blake, we hear Henry James, we even hear Badiou, the contemporary French philosopher. And all of this is surrounding this idea of truth and art. What is truth and art? Is it realism or is it something much more than that?
Oh, well, the great films, the great movies, the truth comes because you go away thinking about it and moved by it or changed in some way by what you saw. There had to be truth there in order for that to occur, I believe. Documentary films, video, this series that we're part of, communication, open communication, free communication. As we're taping this, I'm thinking of what's going on in Iran, where people are trying to be just simply communicate and say what they hope for, and they're being punished for it. And that happens around the world a lot. When I first started writing this novel for children, we had a senator a southern senator who was trying to shut down the federal government's support of the arts, which hurt me to think about.
I think it would for all of us in
yeah,
the series.
Yeah, I think that it's great that there are so many nonprofit, creative enterprises, artistic. Here in Philadelphia, we are lucky to have rich cultural resources and lots of eager dancers and poets and choreographers and the Fringe Festival and mm-hmm. wonderful things.
Is part of writing for children showing them the truth in art and its importance?
Yeah, I think when people talk about writing for children, they often say, oh, well, children people are writing with less worry about what children can handle, but they usually mean violence or something. I think it's surprising that you read historic novels for children and they never mention that people could be punished for changing their religion or something. So there are taboos, and so taboo is one of the subjects in this novel. You know, you can't be a sculptor, you're a girl, or you have to change your religion because the king changed his religion and that's the deal, or other unfair things. So I'm happy to be writing that novel and trying to finish it this year.
Well, hopefully when it's finished, you can come back with us and discuss it further.
That'd be great.
Any final thoughts on poetry for our listeners tonight?
There's more where these came from. And support your local poets. Go to poetry readings, poetry jams. Notice that poets usually are enjoying themselves a great deal.
So poetry is fun?
Yeah, it's fun. It's fun to listen to. It's fun to publish. It's fun to create magazines, to create events.
Great. And, well, it's certainly been fun having you with us tonight. Thank you for joining us on the Philadelphia Cultural Forum. And thank you all for joining us. Good night.